Hello, and welcome to my talk, Extending the Open Source KVM Hypervisor for Android. I'm Will Deacon, I work in the Android Systems team in London, and I'm going to talk about how we've taken the upstream KVM hypervisor, it's a mature hypervisor deployed for a number of years within Linux, and extended it for Android. And the interesting thing here is that the KVM hypervisor is a well-established mature hypervisor, part of Linux kernel, and we're extending it so that we can deploy it in Android on your phone. So before I go into the sort of nuts and bolts of the hypervisor, I'm going to talk a bit about what we're doing here. So the thing we're working on is actually called the Android Virtualization Framework. Of course, that's also known as AVF because we have to have a three-letter acronym for most of these things. And the AVF achieves a number of things. I've listed sort of three high-level things here. On the left-hand side, enables dynamic hardware-accelerated virtual machines in Android. The important part here is that by enabling dynamic virtual machines, Android doesn't need to have any knowledge of the virtual machines you want to run, for example, when you turn your phone on. So you can create, configure, spawn, manage, destroy these things completely at runtime, which is really, really flexible. There's no ingrained knowledge necessarily of the actual VM payloads in the hypervisor. And secondly, they're hardware accelerated, meaning that the CPU has extensions to support the running of virtual machines. They run relatively quickly near native speeds. And when your VM is running, it's sort of running on the metal, if you like. So that's the one thing that the AVF supports. It was launched in Android T, and it's actually shipped on the Pixel 7. So if you've got a Pixel 7, you've got Android Virtualization Framework. You can go and have a play with it. So I'll talk a little bit about that at the end with some pointers to documents you can read if you're interested. And then thirdly, on the right-hand side, the really interesting thing about AVF, and I think what sets it apart from at least traditional uses of virtualization and specifically with KVM, is that the virtual machine environment actually provides an isolated confidential computing environment, meaning that the data in the virtual machine by default is not accessible to the rest of Android. We don't guarantee availability, so Android still decides when to run a virtual machine, when not to run it, even when to tear it down. But the data within that virtual machine remains confidential by default. And that's really important. That's kind of the big thing that we've done differently with AVF. So that's AVF. It's a bit of a whistle-stop tour because I haven't got very long, but the key part of AVF that enables this is protected KVM. So this is not three letters, it's four, pKVM. It's the extension to KVM that we have implemented to enable this confidential computing. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about what that looks like and roughly how it works so that you get some idea of what we've done. So this rather daunting looking block diagram, on the left-hand side, we have user space at the top down to OS kernel, which is where your operating system runs. And then at the bottom, we have the hypervisor. So that's the most privileged at the bottom. And these correspond to exception levels in the processor. So on the left-hand side, that dotted box that's labeled host, and that's actually, in AVF, that's your main Android. That's your Android system. You turn on your phone, it boots up Android, it's booting the host. And you have apps, you're used to apps, you've got services, you've got your Android Linux kernel running as the OS kernel. But there's a couple of things here worth looking a bit more closely at. One of them is the green box marked CrossVM. So that's actually part of the Chrome OS project, CrossVM, Chrome OS Virtual Machine Monitor, I think it stands for. And that talks to the Android Linux kernel, and specifically it talks to this thing called KVM, the KVM driver. And that's the way that the Android Linux kernel is going to talk to the hypervisor to manage virtual machines. So that red KVM box can then talk down to the hypervisor box to manage the virtual machines. So the virtual machine we have here is the dotted box on the right-hand side labeled guest. And it looks pretty similar to the host, right? We also have apps. We also have services. You can run Linux applications and to some extent Android applications. It's more of a limited environment, but more on that. We're using a trimmed down Linux kernel called the Microdroid Linux kernel. So this whole environment in the guest is actually known as Microdroid. It's a small Android designed for running small payloads in this confidential environment. And the reason we can trim down Microdroid, the Linux kernel for Microdroid, is because we don't need all the bells and whistles that Android has. So even the networking stack, we don't necessarily need all of that, for example. So we can really make quite a small payload for these VMs, meaning that it's less memory overhead and it can boot more quickly, things like that. So that's all based on Linux. We've also got uBoot in the guest, which is used as the bootloader to boot that microdroid. So the protected KVM is the hypervisor at the bottom. I've had to mark this as not to scale because it occurred to me that judging by this diagram, it looks like it's about three times the size of the Linux kernel. That's not true. It's really quite small. In fact, that hypervisor component is actually part of the Linux kernel. It peels off during boot, and I'll explain how that works later on. It's about 100 kilobytes of text. It's really not very big. And the thing it does, which is crucial to this confidential environment that we're talking about, is it installs this stage two translation around the host and around the guest. And I've drawn that in the corner of the relative boxes. The stage two translation effectively partitions up the physical memory in the system to say, hey, the host can only access these pieces of memory and the guest can only access these pieces of memory. And that's what gives you the confidentiality, because it enforces ownership and permissions for each page of memory. So what exactly is being protected? I'm going to walk through a couple of scenarios here about how this protection works. So the first one here is when the hypervisor detects an access violation. And I'm going to go through this step by step, but imagine we have a protected virtual machine. PVM is your three-letter acronym for that. And it asks Android for some memory, because Android is dishing out the memory, the physical memory in the system. So the PVM says to Android, hey, I'd like some memory, please. Android donates this memory to the PVM. Now, this transition for the memory means that the memory is now owned by the PVM and becomes inaccessible to Android. So no longer accessible to Android, becomes read and writable by the PVM. But let's say that an Android attacker now attempts to access the memory, and you can tell this Android attacker on the right-hand side is evil because he's got these glaring red eyes. He's going to try and access that memory that is just donated to the PVM, and the hypervisor will detect the access violation, prevent the access going ahead, and you know, slap it on the wrist, and I'll talk about how that works. Interestingly, the same mechanism here is also what protects Android from the PVM. So it's mutual distrust. The stage two translation, which is used to control this ownership, isolates the guest from the host, i.e. the PVM from Android, but also Android from the PVM. So here we go, step one. I just walked through it. Let's go through it step by step. So here's the PVM on the right-hand side. It says, hi, Android, please can I have some memory? And that message goes via the hypervisor back to Android. Android says, sure, here are 4 kilobytes just for you. And you can see this 4 kilobyte page being transferred over to the PVM. And this is not a copy. This is really a change of ownership for that physical page. The PVM is, wow, so generous, because it's 4 kilobytes. For some reason, that's still the page size, even though it was sort of originates from the 60s, but hey, that's where we are. The pKVM hypervisor, during this transition, goes and updates the stage two page tables on the left-hand side, the one left. So crucially, it's going to actually update 2 stage 2 page tables there. It's going to update Android stage two page tables to say you no longer have access to the page, and it's going to update the PVM stage two page tables to say you now have access to the page. So they're the updates that the hypervisor is going to do, along with some security checks to make sure that that's a legitimate transition. And now the attacker comes into play. You know, we've got the page. You can see that it's inside the PVM down at the bottom, because it's only accessible by the PVM. It's owned. And actually, the PVM has mutated the data, so that those ones and zeros have changed a bit. It's got some secret information in there. I think it's actually the ASCII for cat. So Android wants to read that secret data. It says, mwahaha, only joking. Now I'm going to read your secrets. And it tries to read it. But pKVM swoops in and saves the day. So the CPU will actually perform a permission check using those stage two page tables. They were updated by the hypervisors to say Android can't access this page. So we'll get an access violation exception to the hypervisor, which will then inject a fault into Android saying, stop that right now. And if it was an access on behalf of an application, that application will be terminated. Crucially, that secret data of cat in the PVM page, Android never managed to read what that was, and PVM's data has not been compromised. So we sort of give an integrity guarantee there. So that's all well and good. You know, we've got this confidential computing environment, we've got mutually distrusting entities, we've got the hypervisor making sure that they can't access each other's memory. But by default, the PVM's memory is none of it's accessible to Android. You can't do a lot with that, because you can't get anything into it. So you can't perform any I/O. So you can't do anything interesting. It's kind of, you know, just running in its own little world that you can't actually interact with. So pKVM provides a mechanism for sharing memory, and this is always initiated by the PVM. So the PVM can choose to share memory back with Android for things like I/O. So in this situation we're going to walk through now, the PVM shares memory with Android. The hypervisor makes the memory accessible to Android. Still owned by the PVM, but it goes into this sort of shared state. And then there's some communication that happens. So same kind of deal. PVM talks to the Android, says, hi again, Android. Let's use this memory together. And it's got some information in there. I think it says dog instead of cat this time. So the hypervisor says, all right, fine. You're very cheerful. And Android says that. Hypervisor is going to go and update the stage 2 page table. So now what we do is we update Android's page table to say, you can access this page. So both the PVM and Android have read and write access to this page. But we also update the PVM's page table just with some software metabits to say, this has been shared with someone. It doesn't affect the permissions. It's just so the hypervisor can track that it's actually been shared with Android. So now you can see that this page is really accessible by both Android and the PVM, and they can use it for shared memory and to bootstrap I/O. And in this case, it says dog, so they're woofing and barking together, and that's your shared memory communication. So that's like the high level protocol of what we've enabled, the kind of things you can do between Android and these VMs, the confidential environment we provide, and how you can share memory back selectively to perform I/O. How do we do it? Well, it's quite clever, actually. This is interesting. So you could ask, is it a kernel? Is it a hypervisor? Well, yes, it's Linux. All of this is part of Linux. So even in that initial diagram I had, which had the hypervisor right at the bottom, with the way it's deployed, it's all deployed as part of the same Linux kernel image. So when you turn on your phone, Android Verify Boot loads this generic Linux kernel, and that's packaged along with the pKVM hypervisor. In fact, the pKVM hypervisor source code it lives in the Linux source tree. So you build your image and it contains the hypervisor. And the new thing we've added for pKVM is during boot, the kernel deprivileges itself. And you can see that as the sort of second column in this diagram. So we start off with the Linux kernel and the hypervisor together, and then they split. So you have the generic Linux kernel running on top now of the protected KVM. And that deprivilege step coincides with protected KVM installing that stage 2, sort of activating that stage 2 translation table for the Linux kernel. And then after that, the kernel can proceed to do all the things it would normally do. In this case, there's no guests, so pretty much all of the physical memory is going to be owned by the kernel, by Android, with the exception of the small amount of memory that's needed by protected KVM, for example, to map its small 100 kilobytes of text. And that just stops the kernel being able to, you know, modify the hypervisor to subvert it. So within the hypervisor, we track every 4 kilobytes of physical memory using using the page table, using this structure. This is the sort of high-level state machine that we have. So you've got an 8 gigabyte phone. Every 4 kilobytes can be in a different state. It could be owned. If it's owned, you've got exclusive access to it. So if it's owned by Android, it's got exclusive access to it. It can share it with other people, it can read, write, execute it, all of that kind of stuff. If you share it with someone, as we saw earlier on, when the PVM shared a page back with Android, it becomes shared owned by the owner. So in the PVM stage 2, it becomes shared owned and shared borrowed in the target. So it becomes shared borrowed in the in Android in the host. And in that case, it would transition from no page, which means there was nothing there because it was inaccessible, to shared borrowed. So this is roughly just how we track these every page in memory with a couple of bits. So I think this whole day is supposed to be about open source. And I think all of the components of the Android Virtualization Framework are open source components, which is really lovely to work with. And normally when people talk about, you know, open source software, particularly with Linux and the Linux kernel, they say, oh, we're standing on the shoulders of giants. But in this case, it's a bit funny because we're sort of building under the feet of giants. We're going underneath. We've got a small reactive hypervisor layer that relies on Linux and KVM. It supports the whole thing. And it's very powerful because pKVM, like KVM, is tightly integrated with the Linux kernel, and it's shipped as part of the Linux kernel image, the GKI binary for Android's case. And that means that the hypervisor can actually use data structures, code, algorithms from the Linux kernel directly. There's nothing to stop it. And there's no sort of stable ABI that you have to maintain. You don't have to worry, for example, about running next week's hypervisor with last year's Linux kernel, because it's all part of the same thing. You update the source code, you just update them both at the same time. And that's very powerful. It means that the kernel can handle an awful lot of things for your virtual machine. It can handle scheduling, it can handle device drivers, it can handle power management. And Linux is quite good at that, so it's nice that we don't have to have that in the hypervisor. It means the hypervisor layer stays very small, it stays very simple, and it's inherently portable because it needs very little knowledge of the underlying hardware. There's a little bit for IMMUs, but by and large, it doesn't need to know anything about the underlying hardware. So we're really leveraging the existing open source KVM and Linux kernel implementation to enable this hypervisor and keeping it small. So what do we want to work on next? Well, like I said, we've been using open source software, but we're not just consuming it. We're actively upstreaming our efforts, and we're not waiting till we're done before we start doing that. So we're actively upstreaming. We've already landed a load of stuff in 6.1, and we're in the Linux kernel, and we're continuing to upstream. We've also upstreamed various things into U-Boot and other open source projects, including AOSP. One of the really interesting things is we're not the only people doing this, right? Confidential computing is quite popular. And there are other solutions which look somewhat different in terms of implementation to what we're doing with pKVM and AVF, but which rely on hardware extensions. So AMD have SEV, Intel have got TDX, ARM have got CCA, and that's all well and good. They've got their own back-end implementations. But when it comes to core code in the Linux kernel, shared code, it's in everyone's interest not to duplicate the core logic. It's easier to maintain, easier to reason about, easier to program for. So we're involved in those discussions as well to make sure that it works for everybody. And we have development trees tracking the mainline kernel releases. So it's not just that we've shipped only in the Android kernels. We're keeping track of all the release candidates upstream and upstreaming as we go. I think one good example of one of those upstream core discussions actually is this thing called guest private memory. So there's a Linux Weekly News article here. It's very good. Go and have a look. The crux of the problem here is that when you donate memory to a PVM, as we saw in that first example, the PVM says, hey, I want 4K. Android gives it 4K of memory. Android can no longer access that. The host kernel, Linux, can no longer access that 4 kilobytes of memory. And Linux isn't really used to that. It's not used to saying this random 4K of memory is now inaccessible. If you access it, you're probably going to kill the system. It's going to have to reboot. Furthermore, we need a way of talking about this kind of memory. We need to be able to talk to user space about memory that is not accessible. So this is challenging, and there's nothing pKVM specific or anything else specific to this. It's just the nature of confidential computing. So we've been working together with the kernel community to develop user ABIs and a proposal that's suitable for everybody. Right now in Android, we've had to do something in the interest of time, but once upstream align on a solution, we will switch Android over to use that. But it's just a good example, I think, of a common problem being solved by different backend implementers. So with that, thank you very much. I hope that was interesting. If you want to get in touch with the team, we have an email alias. It's quite busy, but you can shoot questions there. We have a Git repository with lots of different trees. If you just want a deeper dive, I've deliberately kept this quite light so that you can get a feel for what we're doing. If you want to go into the technical details, there's a deep dive talk from KVM Forum from my colleague Quentin Perret. That's the YouTube video there. That's great. It's about an hour, maybe a little bit longer, of quite technical material on the hypervisor itself. Alternatively, if you're interested in actually interacting with MicroDroid and trying to spin up a virtual machine, perhaps on your Pixel 7, the documentation at the bottom should help you with that. So with that, thank you very much, and I hope that was enjoyable.